Hey there, everybody. Just wanted to do... Well, I had an idea for a quick little bonus video, just because I was a bit curious. I'm sure as some of you have noticed, the game is not especially long. And I was thinking, well, exactly how long would it be if I wasn't, you know, trying to play it fully to show off everything that I could? So, I don't really call this a speed run, but I was just curious to see how long it would take us to really get back to where... I guess we are currently, and I guess what would be the absolute fastest way through the game. So, I am doing live commentary just to see how that goes. It's not going to go well. It's probably going to go poorly, but I'm at least going to do my train of thought here. So, obviously, you want to skip the chandelier death. Saw that in that other bonus video. And the very first thing we want to make sure and do is go ahead and grab that key from the clock over here. Because we are racing the clock, as it were. Ah, just popping my arm. Because I'm an old man. And old men play old men games. So the first thing we want to do, we want to head... I don't want to jump. Use our brand new iron key. Obviously not falling into the hole. Now, as far as I know, or at least so far that I've been able to find out, the silver key that you get in this room, it doesn't seem to have a purpose. It's completely hidden, and so far, I have not found any use for it whatsoever. Bit strange. No, no one take that, because that's a death trap. Yeah, as I'm sure some of you have noticed, the text goes by a bit quickly sometimes, and that's because I've had to speed up the emulator to make it run, I would say, reasonably well. And by doing that, it does end up causing the text to sometimes just fly by, though... Not really missing that much with that. I did have another idea for a possibly humorous bonus video, probably after the final update. And that will involve a bit of reading. But for now, we don't have to really worry about that. Though I do want to continue giving massive props to, I think, Arcane Aria? For translating the game. Really can't say enough of how great it is to not only be able to do this LP, but also to have people be given the opportunity to play this game themselves. Because, I mean, it's not the greatest game in the world. It's definitely got a lot of perks that I'm glad some people in the comments have been nice enough to point out. It's just, I mean, it's a little piece of history that can be easily overlooked, especially given its, limited release. I mean, I looked up a little bit more on River Hill Soft and what else they did, and they honestly did a very weird collection of games. I mean, their most well-known title is probably Overblood. And I think that game gets a bit of a bad rap as being a Resident Evil ripoff, when in reality it's more of a follow-up to Dr. Hauzer here. And it just so happens that, you know, most people out there in the Western society only really got to experience, you know, Resident Evil. So, can't really conceive this as being a follow-up to a game they've never played. But yeah, River Hill Soft, as far as I could tell, outside of, like, a few semi-popular niche titles like Overblood, or I think there was a game called J.B. Harold Murder Club, which was like a text-based mystery game where you had to solve an actual rape/murder that occurred in the U.S., and... That apparently didn't go over very well. But yeah, they made those games, but they were also very well known for making ports of other games to very small titles. Or small consoles, I should say. Well, at least in, you know, an American audience. Like, they ported Prince of Persia to, like, the PCFX, which was a very... It was like NEC made a Sega Saturn, which I know won't make a lot of sense, but it's like the people that made the TurboGrafx decided to make a competitive system for the against the PlayStation, and it only released like 30 titles, and half of them were like weird hentai, erog, you know, adult shit, let's say. And yeah, they did that, and I mean, it was fine for, you know, if you're into that, but yeah, the PC FX obviously bombed massively. I'm just gonna skip this, because we can! We're trying to do this as fast as possible. I think so far we're doing well. I mean, respectively, I don't think we need to get anything in the library. Hey, it's Dr. Hauzer. Super spooky! That's why we're running as fast as we can. But yeah, they seem to have at least some creative force behind them. Some creative juices flowing. It's just... they picked just the wrong horses to back, honestly. And I get, well, I mean, it might have been right for them, you know, if they were wanting to just stay to a Japanese market. And that's fine, but, you know, larger developers want to make sure that they're not stuck to, you know, releasing games on the MSX. Not to say there's anything wrong with the MSX, it's just, you know, American audiences are never going to, experience your game, which can be a bit of a bummer. And, well, not just American audiences, but as far as I know, the MSX never really made it outside of you know, the Japanese market. Yeah, let's just take the key. Hooray! Also, just out of curiosity, I'm assuming you can't get killed by this. Yeah, can't even run over there. That's fine. But yeah, I mean, It's just good nowadays with the use of emulators that we can, you know, experience some of these titles. And fan translations allow us to experience. I've still been really looking forward to playing the Mizurna Falls translation. I mean, like, the actual translation is done. It's just that the person, I guess, implementing the translation into the actual ISO for, I think, the PS1 is just really taking its time, which is fine. I mean, all these are fan products, so you can't really go to people and go, hey, why aren't you making this fan thing quicker? Whoa. Wow, that's weird. Well, he's seriously... oh, did not know that. But yeah, there was a weird little animation that I totally missed when I was playing. So I guess if you don't look at the painting there and get the whole walk calmly spiel... Adam will, I guess, knowledgeably be afraid of the bottomless pit there. Just a nice little thing that I didn't even realize was in the game. So we are learning. Speaking of learning, we are pretty close to where we left off in the videos. Just need to quickly deactivate that arrow trap. Dr. Hauzer watched some episode of the Three Stooges and was like, that's hilarious. I'm sure I should implement that inside of a clock. You know, I could probably think of some joke involving an arrow and a clock and... I mean, I guess I could be the punchline. It's like, oh, what time is it? It's arrow o'clock. That's a punchline, right? It's not really. I'm sorry. Yeah, roughly coming in at about the 10-minute mark here. And yeah, we have come all the way full circle to where I left off in the videos. So what roughly took me about an hour of proper LPing time, though in all reality, what you guys see is after many, many hours of testing and, you know, doing, test runs or whatever you want to call it, in all reality, it ends up being about 10 minutes of actual game time. Or I guess, we now have this great speed run and I can go to AGDQ and, be top of the pops with my 10-minute long Dr. Hauzer run. I know you guys will be behind me whenever I submit my application. I don't know what they do for that shit, but, see me there, 2020 AGDQ Dr. Hauzer. But yeah, thank you for watching. Hopefully this was informative, and hopefully you guys are ready for the final part. See you then.